Same, Corey.
But I love some Chris, man. Don't do the people like that. I'm not no singer, bro. You're the singer, sir.
You're the singer. Go ahead and intro this podcast. Welcome, welcome, welcome to the next installment of Blassic. It is me, your host Louis B, and
your boy K-Rob.
We are back for another one. We are back for a Christmas episode. Like we can do, only in Blassic fashion, man. Mm-hmm. We was trying to figure out a couple movies that we wanted to do. Mm-hmm. Some shit happened, and last week was last week. I hope y'all enjoyed the Idlewild episode, too.
Mm-hmm. One of my personal favorites.
One of my personal favorites, most definitely. We had to figure out our way around copyrights and issues like that. So now we know that Universal Movies, we can't fuck with. So we hope that y'all enjoyed the audio that we gave y'all for that. And as for always, man, make sure y'all are checking out Blassic on all streaming platforms. We are everywhere. Apple Podcasts, Spotify Podcasts, YouTube. If you want to see your visuals. Listen, man, we are everywhere. So this week's movie, man, we wanted to do a Christmas classic, a Christmas Blassic, if you will. And we decided on This Christmas. This Christmas, a Blassic like none other. I love this movie simply because, to me, I feel like we had good holiday movies in the 90s. Mm-hmm. And then somewhere it kind of just fell flat. Like the holiday genre fell flat. And let's just face it, that's probably one of the easiest movies you could do. Like, it's a holiday film. It's guaranteed gonna get played at this time every year. Right. And I just don't know how Black Hollywood just fell flat.
I think is basically what you said, is once you make a couple of them, you're used to seeing that same movie. So you can just go back and watch Home Alone or whatever the fuck you're watching. It's, you don't feel the need to watch it until that demand becomes high. And the nigga was like, well, where are the niggas celebrating Christmas at? So, yeah. And then we got like two or three of them now. And so now we're watching the two or three, comparing the two or three when it's time to make our other ones a few down the line. Mm-hmm. So that's probably what it is. This Christmas did actually release in 2007. To be exact, it was released November 21st, 2007. That's the perfect timing, of course, because you lean into Christmas. Mm-hmm. And the budget was $13 million. You want to guess how much it made?
How much did it make?
It made damn near $50 million. So that's actually perfect for that type of movie. Of course, they're not going to open like a Marvel movie or anything like that. Mm-hmm. So we're going to shout out the cast real quick. The cast is star-studded. We got Loretta Devine. We got Delroy Lindo. We got Idris Elba. We got Regina King. We got Sharon Leal. We got Columbus Short. Mm-hmm. We got Laura London. We got Chris Brown in like maybe his first big movie. I think he did...
Stump the Yard was right before that.
Right, but
same year, and then
that was 2 minutes of a bullshit ass scene.
Hey man,
that's not
counts. Right. He was on fire.
Bro, I said big movie. We also got Lance Alonzo. We got the late great Ricky Harris, and we also got David Banner and Mekhi Phifer as well.
Honestly, that was a small little Stump the Yard reunion, because you got Columbus Short, Chris Brown, and Laz Alonzo, so...
Oh, I forgot he was in that movie as well.
Yeah, it's pretty interesting to see how, you know, same studio, same production people, and, you know, they kind of picked the same people for the same movies. I love how they used to do that back then, because nobody gave a fuck. Like, I think everybody now is just like, he did this movie this year, we can't put him in this shit.
Well,
like,
yes, if you fast forward a few years later, you also had Regina King, and you also had Delroy Lindo in The Harder They Fall as well. So I mean, they and to the that's oh and Idris, that's Idris Elba as well. Yep. They were all in Harder They Fall. So yeah, that's pretty dope. The movie made money. That was a great cast, great cameos. It had decent award nominations, not that that matters. MTV Award Breakthrough Performance for Chris Brown, of course. Image Award for Loretta Devine, they was nominated for that. Chris Brown was nominated for that. But the one that actually got one kind of piqued my interest, and she's great in the film. The Asian Excellence Award went to Outstanding Actress in the Movie, Sharon Leal. So that means she's like half Asian. And that kind of threw me off. Nah, she looks like she could be mixed, but Sharon Leal, and that's another thing I'm going to tap on when we get into the actual movie
itself. That is interesting.
She is great. And the idea that the only award that was won was one Outstanding Actress in the Movie at an Asian Excellence Award. That's crazy.
Wow.
That's crazy.
Huh.
Yeah.
Let's go ahead and break down this movie, man. So, listen, I'm starting off here because I don't like the name Madeir. I think that who uses that in black?
I think that's
have you heard of that before that movie?
Yeah, I mean, Madeir. I don't know. I mean, a black man wrote this, so
you don't
I'm
gonna
say
off of Madeir and they couldn't use it.
No, this is way. I think this is way before that. I really do think that's probably like some old. If anything, Tyler Perry kind of took that and. I think we just know that from Tyler Perry. Now he's made that mainstream, but I'm pretty sure that is some, you know, we have some off the wall names.
So
but
yes,
I'm gonna tell you now, bro. I don't remember all the character names.
Oh no, I got you. So okay. Madeir is basically the matriarch of the Whitfield family. Yeah. She got six kids by this nigga named who was his name? Michael
they
Whitfield.
All, yeah,
senior.
they call him senior. I remember that. Yeah. I caught that this time.
Joe, who is played by Delroy Lindo, mm-hmm. is her man. You know what I'm saying? They've been together for fucking ever, and I think it's the most interesting thing that they're trying to hide the fact that they live in the house. So pretty much, this is what happened. Madeir is with Michael Whitfield Sr., right? Mm-hmm. So Michael Whitfield Sr. is a musician. He says, fuck my family and my six kids and my wife. I'm going to pursue my music career. The family don't even know where this man is at. They don't know where he's been at for like the past 20 odd something years.
I think knows though. I think she knows. I think that was one point.
I don't know.
I think I remember saying she knows.
I don't know, because I really feel like she's just like, I don't know where this nigga at. He's like, it's just a weird, really weird situation. So he just left the family. Mm-hmm. And Joe lives with her, like I said earlier. They've been living in the house this whole time. Joe has literally been in the picture since some of these characters were kids. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of weird how like they're trying to hide the fact that they live together. All the kids are grown. They know that they live together. So they're just watching them play this whole charade. But that's another story for another day.
No, I think we need to get into this because I do believe this is something that in the black community we tend. This is what I was saying before we started. I think that's something that's a curse in the black community. I think that's and it gets towards the end of the movie. It's her. It's really her. I think the problem is not the kids. I think it's her.
Oh, no. The problem was it's definitely her.
It's her. It's one other person, but it's her. Because
she was doing too much and you didn't have to.
Right. It's
like,
definitely
we know.
Her. Yeah.
So basically, just like in all these Christmas movies, fam.
Or family movies.
Yeah. Christmas family movie. Everybody's getting together for Christmas. And of course, everybody getting together for Christmas. Everybody has their own individual stories mm-hmm. that just kind of set this shit off. Quentin, played by Idris Elba, he's probably the black sheep of the family. He's also a musician. He's the oldest. Mm-hmm. And he pretty much followed in his dad's footsteps. He's not around like that. So I keep that tabbed over. Mm-hmm. Lisa is the oldest girl. She mm-hmm. feels like she runs the family, but honestly, it's her husband that is really the plug in her head. Mm-hmm. With all of her decision making. We'll get to that later too.
She runs her actual blood family. Mm-hmm. She makes everything run. The family business. We got the dry cleaning business. But her own family, she kind of, you know.
Ain't running shit.
She's like the homemaker type man.
Claude, who is played by Columbus Short, he is a Marine who basically, in order to get to the family's house this year, he goes AWOL.
Yeah.
We'll talk about that a little bit later on. Mm-hmm. And his secret is that he's hiding the fact that he's dating a white girl.
Married. Engaged. He's married to a white girl. Which I thought they kept.
It was too much in that part, right?
If it was any nitpick, which I don't do, I don't like everybody's reaction.
Because it wasn't that deep. I don't even like him hiding her. Like, none of this is that deep.
Nah, I didn't. That was the only part I was like, even in 2007, this might be a little too much. Yeah. But go ahead.
Kelly is the middle child. She is played by Sharon Leal. She's the middle child. She's like an ad director for an agency out in NYC. She doing good. So, of course, to get her to come back for Christmas, you know what I'm saying? This is a big deal.
Yeah.
Her and Lisa, they butt heads as sisters normally do. So those are the two sisters that... And they bicker all the time. One of them has to be right in every situation. So that's who she is. Mel, who is played by Lauren London, she, to me, is the most least problematic character of the entire thing. Listen, Shawty is a college girl from Spelman. She met her Morehouse nigga, and she just coming back for the holidays to just chill.
Yeah,
she has no storyline that is problematic in any way. She just coming home from school. I love that about her.
Right.
And then there's Baby, who is played by... Chris Brown. Mm-hmm. We already know what he do. I think the thing about him, he has a special gift that we'll talk about in a little bit. So, of course, all of the family has gotten together there at the house. Everybody's, you know, trying to figure out what the next couple of days is going to be looking like. Everybody's good. Mm-hmm. They're having a little get together that night, you know. I love that they're doing the little Soul Train dance line. It's really certain points in the movie that just make me happy to be black, and you just see blackness going through the screen in certain points. But a big part of this, Quentin Jr. pops up at this get together. You know, they wasn't expecting Quentin to come, so he pops up. I'ma just say this nigga popped up just to lay low.
He did not
pop up to hang with the family.
He definitely did that.
Being with the family is just a plus at the moment. He's trying to hide because he owes some bookies. He owes some niggas about $20,000 to $25,000. This nigga's in some serious debt. Mm-hmm. And these niggas been looking for him. They've been trying to find him. They can't find him now because he's hiding at the family house.
He was originally where? The movie takes place in L.A., which I absolutely love because I don't think you get a lot of those Christmas movies in L.A., but I forgot where he came from. So I thought that was that's my favorite time, you know, part.
Who knows where that nigga was coming from? What his dad doing.
It was a train. It was a train ticket to maybe New York or something. I feel like it was in New York or something like that. But yeah, you're 100% right. He ends up there. Laying low. They didn't expect him. And, you know, everybody's starting to file in. I think the big problem is the mom has been with the boyfriend and now she's getting older. They're getting older. They have this big house. They're trying to figure out what they're going to do with the family business. Mm-hmm. And so they have to take a family vote. So everybody got their own thing. You know, Lisa, Regina King, her husband wants her to go ahead and sell it. But of
her
course,
husband wants her to right. sell the family business.
Cheating husband.
This nigga's not the family. He right. family, but he... You're subject to change.
Right. Cheating husband on top of that. And Sharon Leal, whatever her name, her characters... The cast is so big and just so perfect. Like, I don't remember the characters' names. I'm not going to lie to y'all. They're just and they're just so perfect. I just know them by name. Sharon Leal, she doesn't like the husband. Mm-hmm. She goes back and forth with the... with the sister, and so she definitely doesn't like the husband. She's like, "No, we're not selling shit. You getting this from your
but
your,
Kelly
your...
she sees through her Lisa's husband's bullshit. Like, she sees through that. We'll talk about
but
that.
But see, the thing is, she don't have a nigga, so it's hard for you. It's hard for no. Here you go. Here you go though. Not for not long, but at this moment, I was trying to think like a woman. It's hard for someone to take your advice when you don't have that individual. That's why I don't give out relationship advice if I don't have a girlfriend.
Yeah.
And so she's like, fuck you. You don't even have a husband.
You ain't got no nigga.
So you can't tell me. I just wanted to point that out. That's what we're going to do here.
So the family is trying to figure out what they going to do for the night. You know what I'm saying? We're trying to get into a vibe. Before that, baby has said, hey, I'm about to go meet up with a little chick. You know what I'm saying? We about to go do what I'm going to do. The family is also trying to figure out what the fuck they going to do for the night. They said, hey, let's go to the club. Same club that they went to is the same club that they discovered that baby can actually sing and that he can sing his ass off. Just like it's something in that family bloodline. That music is going to be in that family bloodline. So it's one of them situations where baby, he knows what his dad did. He knows the reputation that his brother has. And he don't want to tell his mama that he's thinking about pursuing music. Because he's hella talented at it.
And this shit is, I'm telling you, and then this is a little bit me personally.
Yeah.
This shit is so real because you got, because I grew up, my dad, you know, he dabbled in music and stuff like that. And I don't know what happened, but then because I was young, that shit didn't pan out. So when I decided that I want to get into entertainment, me not having children or anything like that to hold me down, originally I was kind of told, nah, that's not going to work. Look at your pops.
Oh, wow.
So that's a very real thing. Wow. And that's what I went back and saw on the second viewing. So, I mean, that's just my comment on
don't
that.
Tear up the black household. Let it thrive.
But, I mean, it's just a cycle, man. You got mom's son, boyfriend. You got all this shit. Mm-hmm. You know, she's trying to hold the young man to here because the other son left. And she can't marry the fucking husband because she's trying to keep everybody there. If I was an old nigga, I'd have been gone. If I was Idris Elba, I'd have been get the fucking gone. I'd be gone, bro.
Now
I think about it,
What's crazy, continuing on with the story, shit, of course, everybody know baby can sing now, so it's like, oh my God, you know, we gotta tell mama, don't tell mama shit, don't do that!
Right, just be quiet.
In the midst of this, my boy Claude is just, you know, the folks still don't know that his girl is white and still don't know that he really is AWOL right now, but he ends up getting arrested. As shit happens, like, fam, you cannot fuck around with the military. Mm-hmm. They will find you.
So what do you think the biggest the disconnect there was? That he was married or white? Because I think it was like a mixture. Because I don't know, like, what was the biggest disconnect? Like, oh, he's married or she's white. I couldn't really tell.
That she was white.
You think so?
Yeah.
I don't know.
They tried to play that shit.
I think a lot of them was like, oh, he's married. And then there was a point where it was like, you got this bitch in a hotel. That's why it kind of switched for me.
Like, everybody's in this fucking house right now. Bring your wife.
That's on him, though.
He was playing around.
I was like, again, we'll get around to that movie, too. Him, I was like, fuck you here. Fuck you in this movie, bro, because you're not being a real nigga, right? And I stand up nigga.
At all.
And I was like, I hate any of y'all white viewers, but I'm like, I know that's not how y'all let niggas or
men treat. Like, we're not staying at the hotel.
Like, that's wild.
It's not happening.
You got
like
the
that.
Bookie staying at your fucking mama's house. Everybody step, we got to get around to that. But I'm jumping ahead, but go ahead.
Nah, you good. So basically, we already talked about Kelly and Lisa, their bickering asses. Mm-hmm. So just like Kevin said earlier, listen, Kelly is on to Shawty. She is on to Lisa husband's shit. Like, I know that when you taking them phone calls, you talking to some bitch. I know that when you're leaving, we're only here for like a week, and you just so happen to have to go to New York these couple days. Like, I know what you're doing, my nigga. I know what you're doing. So, of course, Lisa ain't trying to hear that shit. They end up having a big-ass scene where they're, like, scuffling in the yard and shit like that. Which was great, because that's just what happens. That's just what happened with sisters. Mm-hmm. So, continuing on with the story, listen, she finds out that shit is getting crazy. She finds out that her husband is an ain't shit nigga. She takes his fucking car and just runs it off of a cliff. That shit was fire.
Don't try that shit. Don't do that.
Don't try that at home. I will say that.
That's movie. You're going to get your ass in jail, ladies.
Results may definitely vary.
Right.
So, of course, you know, she found out that he cheated. She did that shit. And she wasn't done with him. He came back home thinking shit was sweet. Thought he was going to get him some sex. Went to the damn... Got in the shower. Shawty put some baby oil on the floor. This was probably one of the best scenes I've seen in a while. Like, at that point, like, just getting back at a nigga, I think that was some fly ass shit. That nigga got out the tub and is just going crazy on the floor, and she whooping his ass.
You saw when he got up, she got the fuck on, though, right? She said, once this nigga get up, I gotta get the fuck on.
If he's ever able to get up.
Yeah, but I mean, I think that was a dope scene. And I think at that point, Regina King was still underrated. At that particular, mm-hmm. I remember in that movie. Like, literally, she's still an afterthought at that point. And yeah. I'm talking about just as far as career-wise. And that's...
Oh, she's definitely...
That may have been right at the tail end of the Boondocks. Maybe right when that was starting. But
she definitely gonna get her flowers here on Blassic. But, of course, with all of that information that we just told y'all, listen, Lisa has her own mind now. So, we not selling the cleaners no more. I had bumped my head. My nigga had my head wrapped around his finger. No more. Got my mind back. That's not happening. So, getting back to Quentin. Listen, he's still owing this money. And like Kevin said earlier, we getting into a situation where the bookies are now at the house because they found out where you are. But the house is just so filled with love and compassion that these niggas end up staying there and they don't really know what they're there for.
This is my favorite example of a movie. I absolutely love it because I could actually, as much as you might sit and say, that's stupid, I loved it.
It shows you
how loving the black family is.
Definitely.
It depends on who you are, just because what your job is, you still may respect the individual. Yeah. I'ma whoop your ass, but I'm gonna whoop your ass when your mom's and your pop's mm-hmm. not looking. And David Banner was pretty cool in that. Him and the other guy, I've seen him several times before. But yeah. David Banner was pretty cool in that.
So while them niggas was sleeping, waiting till the morning, thinking that Quentin was still in his room, Quentin got the fuck on. He said, I'm out of here, mm-hmm. I'm dipping. His niggas ended up at a train station or something like that. Of course, them niggas figured out that, hey, he's gone now. So they're finding out where he is, and they ultimately find him at the train station. Now, what's cool is that Joe, the whole movie, he's trying to show Quentin that, hey, I'm not your enemy, bro. Like, I've been in your life this whole time. Your mom loves me. I'm not your dad. Your dad is a piece of shit. He ain't never say that. But he's like, dog, his whole stance is like, I'm stepdaddy and I'm that nigga. And I've been that nigga. I've been good to y'all.
It was
fuck
only,
with me.
Right. It was only this viewing that I realized how long he had actually been there. Because when they started talking
about the kid stories with right, Quentin, I was like, oh... Like, he's been here forever.
Right, and the way they talk about it was like, oh, they've been there for 4 years, like, living there for 4 years. But he started talking about, like, and this is how you know, like, you once you mature, you start listening. He was like, elementary school and shit. I was like, all right, nigga, you think your dad's coming back, and he's never coming back. You come on. And that's the thing with Idris Elba, I was like, ah.
Yeah.
Well, I gotta say something else about Idris Elba. Ooh.
So Joe, he ends up coming to say today at that point. Of course, he wasn't about to get them niggas $20,000. He said, "Hey, here's 10. Y'all niggas ain't really built like y'all think y'all built. So take this shit, get the fuck out of here." What I hated was that Idris was still hating on him. He was kind of just like, "All right, appreciate it, bro," and just got the fuck on.
But that's people. That's a part of real life right there, and that's how people are sometimes.
Yeah, it happens just like that. So. At this point, shit, Quentin leaves again, and we don't expect him to come back. But now we're at Christmas. Mm-hmm. Now this is where shit gets really good, man. You know, most black families, they go to church on Christmas Day. So when they get to church, somehow, hey, Joe already knows that his baby can sing. So he thought it would be a good idea that, hey, during this service, we gonna try to win your mama over, because prior to that, he told his mom that he could sing, and his mama was definitely not having that shit, according to how things ended up with Senior. So,
and the brother. Yeah.
Yeah. So, of course, she wasn't trying to have that shit, but Joe was definitely like, hey, baby, go ahead, get up and sing for us. He gets up, sing his rendition of This Christmas, and he makes his mom happy, because ultimately, she realizes that, hey, I can't stop this nigga from doing this shit. He good. Whatever happens will happen. He sings. He gives us that beautiful rendition. Of course, it's a classic. And, at that point, Claude comes back. They let him back in. He's not arrested anymore. And they know that his girl is white. So Christmas is here, man. Right. Everybody's back at the house and everything is good.
Right.
Like,
yeah, when you were just sitting here talking, right, I was thinking about something. You know, I think the biggest problem, the biggest disconnect, or the biggest thing that was going on in the movie is Madea not allowing the black men...